I never get tired of hearing that song.
Me neither. I love singing about how the world is going to be so much better when Jesus returns.
That's right. When Jesus returns, everybody's going to be healthy.
Everyone's going to be healthy?
That's right. No one is going to be sick after Jesus returns.
Wow, that'll be wonderful. You know, my grandma has been sick lately, and my mom has to take her to the doctors every week.
I'm so sorry to hear that, Susie Q. We should remember to pray for your grandma. But also, your grandma won't be sick after Jesus returns.
My grandma won't be sick at all?
She won't be sick at all. No more sickness. She will be completely healed and healthy after Jesus returns.
Wow, I can't wait!
That's why we should always pray for Jesus to return and heal all the sick people.
Oh, I'll remember that.
Good. Now, if you're out there on the internet watching, please log in and say hi, or have your parents do it. Say hi to Buckaroo and Susie Q. If you're out there, we want to know you're there. We want to hear from you. So let us know you're watching. And please stick around for Bring on the Sabbath. Now, Susie Q, where's Buckaroo today?
I think he's in the house. Hey, but before we call him out, I have an idea.
What kind of an idea?
Well, I'll bet when Buckaroo comes out, he's going to say he's good for nothing.
What? Why would Buckaroo say something silly like he's good for nothing?
I don't know. We'll just have to see if he says he's good for nothing.
Okay, Susie Q. But I don't know where you come up with these things. All right, now let's all call Buckaroo together, all right? Because we know she's not going to do it loud enough. Let's do it on count of three. Ready? One, two, three.
Buckaroo!
What? What? Who's calling? Hey, it's all my friends on the internet. How y'all doing today out there?
I think they're doing fine.
Yeah.
Hey, Buckaroo, I have a question for you.
Oh, question? Sure. What's up, Susie Q?
Oh, where have you been the last few weeks?
Oh, I've been over at my grandma and my grandpa's house. I love to spend time with my grandma and my grandpa.
Oh, that's what I heard. And I hear they give you money sometimes.
Oh, yeah. Sometimes my grandma and grandpa, they give me money. Yep.
And the only reason they give you money is so you'll be good?
Oh, no, no. They don't give me money so I'll be good. They give me money just because they're nice to me.
Really? Are you sure they don't give you money just so you'll be good?
No, no, they don't give me money so I'll be good. I mean, I'm good for nothing. Wait a minute, that didn't come out right. Wait.
See, Ms. Nancy, I told you he'd say it.
I mean, it don't take money for me to be good.
Forget about it, Buckaroo. Susie Q was playing a trick on you.
Oh, I get it now.
Took you long enough.
All right, now we have to run. I have to run back to my house for a minute. I want you two to behave while I'm gone.
Okay, we'll see you later.
Yeah, we ain't going nowhere. Bye, Miss Nancy.
Buckaroo, I have another question for you. I see you have a shovel lying on the ground there in your backyard. What are you going to do with that shovel?
Oh, yeah. I'm going to bury something back there.
Bury something? Well, that sounds exciting. What are you going to bury? Some treasure or something good like that?
No, 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 nothing like that.
Well, I hope one of your dogs didn't die.
No, no, my dogs are fine.
Then what are you going to bury in your backyard?
Well, can you keep a secret?
Well, of course I can keep a secret.
All right, but don't tell anyone.
Well, I won't. Now tell me.
Buckaroo is going to bury his guitar in the back. That's what I'm going to do.
What? Your guitar in the backyard.
Well, Yankee Dan says I need to stop playing my guitar.
What? Why would Yankee Dan tell you to stop playing your guitar? Oh, that's awful.
No, no, he's not being awful. He's trying to help me.
How can Yankee Dan help you by telling you to stop playing your guitar? This is just terrible.
Well, it's because, well, wait a minute. I see him coming over here. Hey, Dan.
What do you want?
Come on up here. I want to ask you something.
Yeah, all right. What do you guys want?
Oh, Yankee Dan, how many times do I have to tell you? It's not yes, it's y'all.
Yeah, yeah, whatever. Now, what's the question? I'm a busy man.
Oh, busy man? Nothing. You're just a kid in the fourth grade.
And you're just a girl in the second grade, so you remember that.
Oh, Yankee Dan, I'm going to...
Wait. Hey, Dan, tell Susie Q why you told me to stop playing the guitar.
Oh, you mean why you should stop?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's it. Why in the world should Buckaroo stop playing his guitar?
Well, he's just doing it to show off. And you guys are always saying you're Christians, so I think Buckaroo should stop showing off.
Oh, that's the craziest thing I ever heard. Yankee Dan, you cause so much trouble around here.
All right, let's stop here. Let me ask Buckaroo a question. Hey, kid, when you play the guitar, does it make you feel good?
Well, sure.
And when you play guitar, does it make other people happy?
Oh, of course it makes makes other people happy.
Yeah, and when you play the guitar, do you like it when people thank you and tell you you did a good job?
Oh yeah, I like that.
See, you're just showing off. I rest my case.
Oh, Buckaroo, don't listen to him. Yankee Dan, you need to quit telling this stuff to Buckaroo.
Ah, whatever you said. Like I said, I'm a busy man. I'm an important man. I got things to do, so I'm leaving. Goodbye, yous guys.
It's not yous, it's y'all. Oh, and you're not an important man. You're just a kid in the fourth grade. Oh.
Bye, Dan. Hey, and thanks so much for helping me fix my problem about showing off.
Oh, Buckaroo, when are you going to stop taking advice from Yankee Dan? Do not bury your guitar in the backyard.
What? What? Take two aspirin and call me in the morning?
Oh, no. We woke up Dr. Nelson.
Bury your guitar in the backyard? Oh, this is not good.
Hello, I'm back.
Oh, I'm so glad you're back. We have a problem.
Oh, no. What is it this time?
Miss Nancy, these children are talking about burying Buckaroo's guitar in the backyard. I do not think this is a sensible idea.
What? I agree.
Has talent. He's very helpful in church with his music.
Yes.
So I need you to talk to these children about using their abilities to help out at home and at school and in church and in their neighborhoods.
I will, Dr.
I certainly will appreciate it if you get this done. You need to help these children to recognize that our church is not just for the adults. Our church belongs to the children, too, and it's important that children always feel that their talents are appreciated in our church.
Of course I will.
Well, please get on this right away, young lady. This is urgent. Now, please do it. I'm going back to my nap.
Good night, Dr. Nelson. Now, what in the world is going on here? I'm gone for like 5 minutes and we have some new drama already?
I'm glad you're back, Miss Nancy. Yankee Dan told Buckaroo to get rid of his guitar.
What? Buckaroo, why in the world would you want to get rid of your guitar?
Well, Yankee Dan said I need to stop showing off, and he says that when I play, I'm just showing off.
Showing off? All right, let's talk about talents. Susie Q, you have a real talent for math. You get excellent grades in math.
Thank you, Miss Nancy.
Buckaroo, your talent is not math.
Oh, wait. Yeah, sure it is. You just asked me a math question. I mean, you asked me any math question.
All right. If peaches are 10 cents each, how many can you buy for a dollar?
None.
None?
I don't like peaches. The fuzz is kind of gross on the outside.
All right. Just pretend you like them. Now, how many could you buy for a dollar?
Well, maybe one.
One? No, 10.
No, there's no way I can pretend to like that many peaches.
Oh, fine. Let's say they're baseballs.
10 cents for a baseball? That's crazy. Hey, Susie Q, Miss Nancy thinks baseballs are only 10 cents each.
All I want to know is how many peaches... Look, it's a simple math equation.
Not the way you asked it.
All right. Let's look at it another way. Now get serious. I want you to focus, Buckaroo. Let's talk about your friend Jeremy.
Oh, you mean Jeremy who lives down the street there?
That's the one.
Oh, yes. He's so dreamy. Oh, he's in high school. He drives a red Mustang. He's so cute.
Susie Q, would you please control yourself? Now, Jeremy's a very nice young man.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. He's a real nice guy.
But what's Jeremy got to do with Buckaroo giving up his guitar?
Well, Jeremy gives you rides to Walmart once in a while, right?
Oh, yeah, he does. He's nice to us. He doesn't yell at us like some of the other high school boys do.
And Buckaroo, remember when a couple of weeks ago you told Jeremy he was real cool because he had that nice car?
Oh, I was there. I remember that. And Jeremy said, no, I'm not cool. He said he just has a rich dad who bought him that Mustang.
Yeah, Jeremy said his car didn't make him cool. He said he could never buy a Mustang. He said he just had a great dad who could buy it for him.
That's right.
But what does this have to do with Buckaroo giving up his guitar playing?
Well, wait a minute, Miss Nancy. I just thought of something. I look at my guitar playing the same way as Jeremy does having a car. Just because I can play guitar doesn't make me cool. My guitar playing is something that God gave me, just like Jeremy ain't cool just because his dad gave him a car.
Yes, now you're getting it. Tell me more.
Oh, I get it. Jeremy is always giving other kids rides to school and baseball games. He shares what he has with other people.
Yeah, he's always taking people places.
He even takes his old Aunt Donna to the store every week.
Yes, it's an important point that Jeremy enjoys sharing.
Yeah, he likes to share.
And that's what you do with your guitar playing. You like to share.
And Buckaroo, here's the important point. Do you think your guitar makes you great?
No, my talent is something God gave me. God is the one who's great. Wait a minute, I can't stop playing the guitar. If I bury my guitar, I'll be burying something that God gave me. Whoa, what was I thinking?
Yes, what were you thinking, Buckaroo?
I think you need to understand something. Jesus talked about in the Bible how a man was going to bury something, and it was wrong.
You mean a guy in the Bible was going to bury a guitar?
No, not a guitar. Not a guitar. He was going to bury money.
Well, I want to hear this story.
Yeah, me too.
All right, it's a parable of the talents, and it's found in the book of Matthew. Jesus told how a rich man gave 5 pieces of gold to one man and 2 pieces of gold to another man, and then he gave 1 piece of gold to a third man.
Well, why did the rich man give gold to these men?
Because he wanted them to do good things with the gold. So the rich man went away for a while, and then he came back, and when he returned, he asked the men what they did with their gold. And the first 2 men did good things with their gold, or with their money, and the rich man was happy with them.
What about the third guy? Did he do good things with his gold?
No, he was lazy. He just buried the gold in the backyard.
Whoa! And what did the rich man say to the lazy man who buried his gold in the backyard?
Well, the rich man was mad at him, and he punished that lazy man and told the lazy man he was supposed to use that gold to do good things. God gives us all talents, and these talents are like gold. Our talents are very valuable. Some people have a talent for math, or spelling, or drawing, or singing, or dancing, or writing, or playing an instrument, or cooking, or serving in other ways. There are many different types of talents, and these talents are so valuable. They're like gold. God wants us to use our talents to do good things. We can't be burying our talents in the backyard like a lazy man did.
Buckaroo, that's exactly what you were going to do. You were going to quit using your talent to play the guitar.
Yeah, I almost made a big mistake there.
You know, you certainly did. People are sometimes like that, though. And you know what? Churches are sometimes like that. Anytime they get money, they keep it for themselves, and they don't do good things with it, like helping people who are poor or preaching the gospel of Jesus.
But, Miss Nancy, all churches are supposed to help the poor.
Yeah, and all churches are supposed to preach the gospel.
You know, that's right. So let's make this our lesson for today. We should always use our talents to do good. Let's see. I want you to say with me, use your talents to do good things. I'll say it again. Use your talents to do good things. Now, I want everybody here, everyone on the internet, and our audience here to say, use your talents to do good things. On the count of 3, are you ready? 1, 2, 3.
Use your talents to do good things.
Great. When Jesus returns, we want to be able to show him and have him be happy with us because we use our talents for good.
Buckaroo, you better keep playing your guitar and not be like that lazy man who buried his gold in the backyard.
Yeah, I'm going to remember that. Hey, it sure was nice for all these kids here to be with us today. I think I'm going to go play my guitar for my grandma and my grandpa. They love it. And I love to go visit my grandma and my grandpa. And when I go to their house, I always give them a big hug and a big kiss. Now, I got to go, but before I go, remember what I always say sometimes, have a good Sabbath. Can you say that with me? 1, 2, 3.
Have a good Sabbath.
Wow!
And now for an important announcement.
Buckaroo Bob's Neighborhood was filmed before a live studio audience, you guys.
It's y'all!
I guess it's just me. Live from Tyler, Texas, it's Bring On the Sabbath!
Bring On the Sabbath, a production of the Church of God International. Broadcast live from Tyler, Texas. Featuring Wes White, Nancy White, Jeff Reed, and the cast of Buckaroo Bob's Neighborhood.
Now here is your host, Wes White.
Good evening and welcome to our 15th Bring On the Sabbath. I guess you could call this our reunion show. Jeff is back from the Philippines, Nancy's back from San Antonio, and I'm back from Chicago and Detroit. While I was up in Detroit, in that area, I spent a lot of time in Dearborn, a city right next to Detroit. We've got a lot of Church of God people living up there in that area. And one of the Church of God families told me about how in the Dearborn schools, there's a lot of diversity. And one day the kids were all told to bring something about their faith for show and tell in school. And the family told me that one kid at show and tell said, "Well, I'm a Catholic and this is my rosary." And another kid at show and tell said, "I'm Jewish and this is my Star of David." Another kid at show and tell said, "I'm a Muslim. This is my prayer rug." Well, the kid from the Church of God went to show and tell and he said, "I'm in Church of God International and this is my casserole dish." We're really into potlucks, aren't we? All right, that's diversity. Diversity is everywhere. Last week, the United States won the International Math Olympiad. And the International Math Olympiad, it's like the biggest spelling bee for math for smart high school kids all over the world. And people were celebrating that the Americans won, and they said, "Oh, Americans can finally compete with Asians when it comes to math." Well, they said that until they saw the names of the kids on the U.S. team. Not making this up, their names were Shyam Narayana, Yang Lu, Alan Liu, and their coach was Po Shen Lo. Now, I didn't get a chance to see any shows while I was on my trip to Chicago and Detroit. When I travel, I like to check out local music shows. And I missed a concert that was being put on in Detroit's Comerica Park. It featured country singer Kenny Chesney. And I'm kind of glad I didn't go because nearly 300 fans were kicked out of that concert of the Kenny Chesney thing for fighting, harassment, and extreme intoxication, which was also the title of the song that he was playing at the time. We have to talk some politics tonight. It was announced last week that President Obama has unveiled his plan to finally shut down the prison at Guantanamo Bay and to make sure that no one ever goes back into the Guantanamo Bay prison again. It's a pretty simple plan he's come up with. He's going to put a Radio Shack sign on it. Yeah, no one will ever go in there again. Also, in political news, Bernie Sanders has gotten the endorsement of the student body of Hillary Clinton's alma mater, Wellesley College. Now, Hillary Clinton was not pleased by that, so she's trying to get even. She's trying to get the endorsement of Bernie's alma mater, Jurassic Park. Now, we get all kinds of interesting things from y'all out there. You're always sending us some real cool stuff. Well, one of our viewers sent us information on the Orange County Fair in California that's coming up pretty soon. And before the show, Jeff and Nancy and I were looking at the menu for this show at the Orange County Fair. And the menu features, get this, deep-fried Slim Fast bars. Yeah, deep-fried Slim Fast bars. I guess this is perfect if you haven't decided yet if you want to be overweight or not. And the fair also features deep-fried pizza, deep-fried birthday cakes, and deep-fried pickles stuffed with peanut butter. Now, what's amazing is not featured at the Orange County Fair is oranges. Not a single solitary orange was on that menu. Now, Nancy and I sometimes stop at Starbucks on our way here to the BOTS broadcast, and she loves for me to pull into Starbucks. She runs in, she gets a coffee. Well, tonight, Nancy was not happy. She found out that Starbucks has unveiled a new reward system. Previously, you only needed 12 reward stars to get a free drink. You now need 125. So Nancy, she's all mad. And she says, "This is so frustrating." She said, "If only there was some way for people to make their own coffee at home." We got a great show for you tonight. Jeff is going to tell us about his trip to the Philippines. Nancy's going to talk about robots taking over your job. And we're going to step on some toes tonight as we continue our series on attracting and keeping young people in the church. So don't go away. Stick around. We'll be right back.
Women are under a lot of pressure these days. For many women, having it all means doing it all. We wear many hats. Wife, mother, sister, daughter, employee, boss, chauffeur, cook, neighbor, friend, and child of God. Continually juggling roles and workloads, do you feel like your spiritual life is being squeezed out? Could you use a break from day to day so you can focus on what is eternal? We want to offer Christian women an opportunity to be refreshed at our women's retreat in Lindale, Texas, on Saturday and Sunday, April 9th and 10th. This is a joint activity sponsored by both Christian Educational Ministries and the Church of God International. This event is open to all women, not just women of our faith. Please check out our website, newchurchlady.org, and see what this woman's retreat is all about. You can read the New Church Lady blog and find information about the conference schedule, location, housing, and how to register. We think you are going to find the cost of attending this event is very reasonable. Give yourself a break from all the stress of being a Christian woman in today's world. Let's spend a weekend together in Christian love so we can be renewed in our faith. Again, that's newchurchlady.org.
We're back. Before Nancy says hi to all the people in the chat room, we got to tell you an important announcement. Next Friday night, that's a week from tonight, it's going to be our last Bring on the Sabbath for a while. We're going to take, we're going to take.
You're fired, Jeff.
I'm fired. The last one for a while.
Yeah, maybe you get a job in the Philippines. They seem to like you there. We're going to take April off because we've got so much travel that we've got to do. Then we're going to resurrect, bring on the Sabbath in May, and we're going to start going through the book of Genesis. We're going to have a lot of fun with that.
That's going to be great.
Please watch for announcements on the date and time of bring on the Sabbath resurrection in May. But make sure that you're back here next Friday night at 7:30 for our final show for a while. Jeff, how are you feeling tonight?
A little travel weary.
a little jet lagged. Huh?
I guess jet lag, little stomach issue. 30 hours of travel, I guess, yesterday, which started out at 4 in the morning in Manila and ended up here by 12:30 at night. So it was quite a day.
All right.
Really pushing it. So,
all right. So y'all pray for Jeff. He's got jet lag. He's got stomach problems. He's got all kinds of stuff.
This is not from going to McDonald's either.
Okay.
This is stomach problems. All right. Led to my travel.
So for those of you who are fans of Jeff specifically, you're not going to hear from him a whole lot because of his jet lag. Well, we're going to let him go take a little nap right now, but we're going to come back to him and he's going to tell us about his trip to the Philippines. Also, we want to mention a couple things about our travels last week. Nancy was in San Antonio for her job and visited her family last week. I was in Chicago and Detroit, and I filmed while I was traveling for Connecting History and the Bible, and I baptized one of our regular Bring on the Sabbath listeners, Kevin O'Hare, who lives in my old hometown of Hessville, Indiana. It was a great baptism ceremony, and I think we got a picture that we're going to put up on the screen of Kevin in the baptism. Before the baptism, Kevin and I read some scriptures. Then his whole family showed up for the baptism. It was great. His mom, his sister, three kids, in-laws. It was so cool.
Wonderful.
We baptized Kevin in the swimming pool of the Marriott Courtyard in Hessville. And when Kevin and I got into the pool, there were some kids swimming. And you never know what's going to happen when you get into a pool to baptize somebody and there's kids swimming. Well, these kids got real quiet. Well, we went through the ceremony. I laid hands on Kevin, prayed for the Holy Spirit and all that. And when we finished, the parents of these kids who were swimming, the parents started clapping.
Oh,
it was
nice.
So nice. Well, then Kevin and I and his whole family went out to eat pizza at the best pizza place in the whole world, House of Pizza.
So let me get this straight. You baptized him and you immediately took him back into corruption.
Yes.
Took him back to pizza.
Back to pizza.
Well, okay. House of Pizza Pizza.
Now, is that the one that you know the phone number to?
Yeah, 844-6065. Yes.
Wow, okay.
Great pizza. Area code 219. I love it when we can make baptism a great ceremony. I got to tell you now, I remember when I got baptized back in 1971. A lot of you weren't even born then. And at that time, I had no relatives in the church. I had no friends in the church. And I'd only been attending church for a short while, so I didn't have a lot of church friends yet. So I felt so alone after the baptism. Well, I get home and I'm, you know, 20 years old, still living with my mother. So I called the only person in the church that I had a phone number for. Let's call him, I don't want to give his name, let's call him GR. And I wanted to share this wonderful news with him. Now, my mom was home, and I had to talk real quiet so she wouldn't hear me. She was hostile to my new religion. What's this Sabbath stuff? So I called GR. I said, hey, GR, guess what? I got baptized today. And GR said, what? And I said, I got baptized today. And he said, you got baptized? That's terrible. You're not ready for baptism. This never should have happened. I'm going to call Pastor Hoops and tell him he made a big mistake baptizing you. Oh, this is so wrong.
Wait, so, Yankee Dan was your only friend in the church?
No, don't go there. Since then, I have always tried to make baptism a really special occasion. I don't want the person to feel alone. I want him to know he now has brothers and sisters in church who are celebrating with him. Anyway, we had a great baptism celebration for Kevin. And I got some comments off of Facebook that I want to share with Kevin, because Kevin's not on Facebook, but I believe he's watching the show tonight.
He is.
Good.
He signs in as Kevin Joe, and people have been saying, welcome to the family.
Good. Okay, here's some people that on my Facebook page that said, there was Mimi, Roger Bright, David and Sylvia, Carl Nocktribe, Darla Cook Bright, Ken Swiger, and they all said things like, welcome to the family, Kevin, congratulations. Michael McCarty wrote, welcome to God's church, Kevin. Beth Hester wrote, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, welcome to the family. Here at BOTS, we have a great family out there every Friday night, and we're so happy for each and every one of you out there. We love fellowshipping with you on Friday night, so this is great. Not long ago, there was a lady in Tyler here who asked me to baptize her, and I was more than willing to do it, but I wanted to make it special, so I organized some singers, got out my guitar, and then I asked another minister to do the baptism so I could play and sing with the singers. You know, let's make it a big day. And we sang one song, I forgot what it was, but then we ended with, Are You Washed in the Blood? Mm-hmm. Well, one of the other ministers beforehand suggested, he said, well, Wes, she asked you to do it. Shouldn't you be the one to do it? And I said, no, I don't have to be the one. I can be more helpful by being part of the musicians than to get another minister to do the actual baptism. Because the day of one's baptism is one of the greatest days of his life. Mm-hmm. And I really wanted to make this a special day for this lady. Also, this is a personal preference. I don't like baptizing someone in private. Mm-hmm. If we can do the baptism with others, I want others to be present. Like when I baptized Sylvia out in West Virginia, it wasn't that long ago, we could only have her husband and her two kids there. We weren't close to a church, so we couldn't invite a lot of church people there. If there were any brethren close by, I would have gotten them there by hook or by crook, because I want the brethren involved in a baptism. I want the person being baptized to then publicly proclaim his profession of Jesus in the presence of others. Because Jesus says we have to profess him publicly. How did we do Lady Tex when she came to be Tyler? Didn't she come here to be baptized?
Yeah, you weren't here that day. Jeff baptized her.
Okay, you baptized her, Jeff.
Yes,
okay,
absolutely.
Where was I?
I think you were preaching somewhere. I think it was Pentecost. Wasn't it Pentecost? It was a holy day. And I think you were preaching somewhere else on
day.
Pentecost.
Okay, I must have been up in Chicago.
Maybe. Yes, I think you did a Pentecost service in Chicago.
All right, I forget.
But we had a very good baptism with Lady.
It was a good day that day.
Great day, great, wonderful. Missed your singing, you know. But it was really good.
Good. Yeah. You know, we seem to have a lot of baptisms in CGI lately. And I hope it shows that we're doing something right. And if anybody out there wants to take this important step of baptism, you contact us here at CGI, and we'll see if we can figure out a way to get someone to serve you in this matter.
Yeah. Well, Lady Tex confirmed it was on Pentecost.
It was. Okay, yeah. Very good. Thank you. All right. Let us know if we can serve you. Let us know in the chat room or email us, wdwhite49@yahoo.com. Because and when we baptize someone, do we say, oh, we're going to baptize you in Church of God International? Do we do that? Absolutely
no,
not.
Absolutely.
No. We baptize them into the body of Christ. We never baptize
them. We actually tell them we're not baptizing you into any denomination.
No, we are not.
You're baptized into
the body of Christ.
Christ, yeah.
And do we, after we baptize a person, do we say, we now own you. You're our property. No,
no.
We don't own you. You belong to Jesus Christ. You don't belong to us or the Church of God International. So if you need to get baptized, let us know. In the meantime, Nancy, who do we have in the chat room tonight?
All right. We have Mimi, Carl, Calgary, John Black, William, Kevin Joe, who is Kevin O'Hare.
All right.
Melvin, Marion,
Joy, Beth and Ed, Jeff, Lady Tex, who we were just talking about, and Super Jim. Those are the people who have signed in.
Terrific.
All right.
All right, we're going to go into our Alpha and Omega current events. And don't forget to chat with us in the chat room. This is where we're having this dialogue. Or send us an email, wdwhite49@yahoo.com. And remember, the reason we do this current events thing is to try to help you to put things that are going on today into perspective. And normally, I am very disdainful of predictions of doom and gloom. I just do not like that kind of stuff. I'm a Christian. I have joy in my life because I've got Jesus Christ in my life.
Amen.
We have got too many people bombarding us daily with doom and gloom. But tonight, I got to say, sometimes, once in a while, we got to sound the alarm. Sometimes we have to say, hey, something's wrong. We got to say something about it. We got to talk about it. Mm-hmm. And tonight, for the first time on Bring on the Sabbath, I don't do this, but tonight, for the first time, I'm going to sound the alarm of doom and gloom, and it has to do with young people in the church. I think that all of us need to be concerned about the gentrification of the Church of God movement. We do not have enough young people in too many of our congregations, and we need to sound the alarm so we can do something about this. So we're going to continue this conversation. We started it in our last show 2 weeks ago. We're going to continue it tonight. And while you're thinking about it, I want to begin our discussion by pointing out the differences between strategic thinking and tactical thinking. If you're taking notes out there tonight, if there's anything you write down, it's these two words, strategic and tactical. Write this down. In businesses all over the world, they understand the difference between strategic thinking and tactical thinking. Tactical thinking is planning for the here and now, the immediate future. Strategic thinking is long-term planning. Tactical thinking is something like this: what am I going to eat for lunch today? Strategic thinking is, what are my long-term goals for diet and health? We have seen a new phenomena in businesses over the last 20 years. Too many companies out there today are not thinking strategically, that is, for the long term. That's because a lot of people who run these companies are only interested in getting themselves some nice big bonuses now, today. They figure, look, I'm not even going to be here for another 5-10 years from now. So they take their bonuses and they run. Today, everything is based on making the next quarter look good, even if it's at the expense of long-term good for the company. These guys doing this deceive the shareholders into thinking that everything's going along real well, but the shareholders figure out in about 10 or 15 years when it's too late and after the current management has moved on to greener pastures. This tactical-only management style hurts the long-term viability of a company. We see this happening in presidential elections, where a guy will say, I'm going to do and say whatever I need to win the next primary. And it may cause me to lose several primaries down the road. It may cause me to lose a general election. But this is what I'm going to do to win this next primary next week. This is really good tactical short-term strategy, but it's really bad in the long-term strategy for the guy's campaign and for the good of the country. We see this happening in our churches too. There are things that get said from the pulpit that have good short-term effect when it comes to numbers, but we pay the price for it later in the long term. In other words, we're neglecting the long-term good of the body of Christ because we think too much in tactical terms. Our present methods are killing us when it comes to keeping and bringing in young people. Now, many people are talking about this problem in the church today. I'm hearing it talked about all the time, but I'm not hearing many solutions. Here at BOTS, we do not have all the answers, but we do have some solutions that we think are kind of good for this problem. And we're going to find that the real problem is that too many people in the church don't want to accept solutions, even after they acknowledge that these are things that need to be done. And why the resistance? Again, because there are sacred cows out there that they don't want butchered. Because we don't want to step on the toes of those who have been doing ineffective and counterproductive things for years or even decades. On this program, tonight we're going to be very frank and very honest about these things. Now, the last time we started the list of areas where we need improvement, we got through two of them, and we're going to finish all our points tonight. We might not be able to get to Nancy's thing about the robots, but we are going to finish this tonight. And we want to hear your points. So write into us, let us know. And I've got some that you've already sent me. I'm going to read them. Our first point 2 weeks ago had to do with the problem of racism in the church and how it needs to be gotten rid of because it is a hindrance to growth. And the other problem we mentioned was the bad habit we have of condemning others whose sins are different than ours. Notice I didn't say we're condemning others who sin. We all sin. The problem is too many times we're mad at the sins of other people because those sins are different than ours, and we condemn them and get obsessed about their sins because their sins are different than ours.
Or we rank them and think they're worse.
Yeah. Again, there are certain sins that will get you kicked out of a lot of churches. Homosexuality is one of them. Again, Romans 1:26 condemns homosexuality, and we teach against it. But you know, we also find scriptures against sins where people are not asked to leave the church over these sins, like excessive drinking, fornication, breaking the Sabbath. These sins are condemned in the Bible, but many times we don't ask people to stop coming to church over them. This is a double standard. And I'm telling you, this is one of the things I hear over and over from young people. Double standards are so glaringly obvious to young people who recoil when they see them. Mm-hmm. Young people pick up on double standards very quickly. Young people hate double standards. And if your church practices any form of double standards, you're going to have to get rid of them, and get rid of them now. All right, let's continue being frank here. Let's go back to point number one that I just alluded to very quickly, the form of racism. I'm going to give you a history thing now. When CGI started in 1978, the decision was made by the founders of CGI back then that CGI would not be a church that promotes racism. From day one, in 1978, when CGI started, CGI was a church that did not forbid interracial dating or interracial marriage. CGI's rejection of racism is part of our original history.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Now I'm going to be even more frank. And I want to share with you a story about a couple I know. And I could give you millions of these stories, but I'm only going to bore you with one of them. Because people are telling me, I don't see what you're talking about racism being in the church. And I'm only going to bore you with one story, but I can tell you many, many more. This couple I want to tell you about, they're not in CGI, but they are part of the Church of God movement. The couple has a son. At one time, the son was shacked up with some gal. They were living together. They were unmarried. And these Church of God parents had no objection. And by the way, the parents and the son and the girl, they're all white. Well, the son breaks up with this girl. They separate. He starts dating a black girl. And he decides, I'm not going to shack up with her. He decides, I'm going to do the right thing and have a right relationship. So he says, no messing around until we're married. The parents were furious with him. They threatened to cut off his inheritance if he married this black girl. And they made it crystal clear to him that they much preferred him to live in sin with the white girl than to be in the righteous relationship with the black girl. How messed up is this?
That's pretty messed up.
Messed up. This is not something we would ever advocate in CGI, but it happens in the Church of God movement. Young people, let's get back to young people. In this day and age, young people usually, I say not always, but usually do not carry the racist baggage that's carried by so many older people. When young people today see racism in the church, they recoil. And if your church has any vestiges of racism, you got to get rid of it. Mm-hmm. You got to get rid of it now. If you see racism in some other branch of the Church of God movement, you got to make sure you have distanced yourself from that racism and that your church rejects it. You've got to make sure that the young people that are in your church that you're involved with or are interested in your church, you've got to make sure they know that you have no part of this problem.
And not just in order to keep young people, but because it's wrong.
It's just the right thing to do.
And again, CGI is part of the Church of God movement, and we have our roots in the Worldwide Church of God.
Right.
And these other churches have that. But I keep up with a lot of what they promote and do. Mm-hmm. And they are, I have to tell you that, they are racist.
Right.
Flat out racist. Mm-hmm. And these are major churches of God who promote these terrible things.
Yes.
And so we have to, not only we're distancing ourselves, we have to point these things out.
Exactly.
You know, and pray for repentance.
Exactly.
On these parts, because, you know, we want the Church of God to be strong.
Because, again, young people are not into this for the most part. I know there are exceptions, but for the most part, young people don't carry this baggage. Mm-hmm. And I confess, and I'm getting off topic here, and I'm going to be very quick. I confess I used to be a racist.
I used to use every kind of negative term about other races, and I was raised in this, and I repented of it in about 1980, I think it was. And we, and so I've got this baggage with me that I've had to let go years ago. Young people in the church today, most of them don't have this. Mm-hmm. It's foreign to them. Mm-hmm. All right, Nancy, what are some of the other Facebook comments that we've already received on this subject?
Okay, before we do that, let me just say we missed Mel VD saying hello, and he's in the room, so.
All right. Hello.
Mimi says she's emailing Wes's Facebook post on the subject to people who don't have Facebook, so she wants to spread the word in a different way. She's going to ask them to email us their comments. Hopefully your email is blowing up there, hopefully. Gary Evans says it's important for us to get young people involved in church.
Involved.
Involved. Not just in the room, involved.
It's their church, too. It's not just mom and dad's church.
So they can pass out songbooks or something.
More than that.
You have ownership. I'm just kidding.
The kids got to know that. All the little kids got to know they've got ownership in the church. Mm-hmm. That's a whole subject. We got to do a subject on that one of these days, how everybody's got to have ownership. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Sandra.
Okay. Gina Anderson of Arkansas says this issue definitely needs to be addressed. And we can understand why Gina's concerned. She's got a couple of kids who are getting into young adulthood.
That's right.
John Black says he sent Wes's Facebook post to his daughter, who was raised in the church, because he wants her to give us her observations. And David Duff from Alabama says it's not just young people. He feels like the church is not attracting anyone new anymore.
Wow. Yeah. Okay.
Lisa Boyd says this discussion is much needed.
Yeah, because the thing is, there's like people my age who are like in their 40s. Who don't like racist churches.
Right.
You know, we want to go to a church that's not racist. It's not just an age thing. And there's probably people in their 60s who don't want to be a part of a racist
church.
That's
true.
Yeah,
that's right.
And older.
All right, so from these comments that Nancy read, I think we've demonstrated that there's a real need to talk about the issue of young people, getting them and keeping them. Nancy, let's continue on. What's our next list of areas where the church needs improvement when it comes to attracting and keeping young people?
Well, let's talk about one of the most controversial subjects in the church, second only to maybe ordaining women, and that's music. Our congregational music is often stale and uninspiring to young people. Our congregations don't bring in new music either because they refuse to it on principle, or because they don't know how to find music that will uplift the congregation. Some of the corporate churches of God have decreed that none of their local churches may sing congregational music that's not already in their approved hymnal.
And CGI does not do that.
That's not true of CGI. Wes and I have visited many CGI churches, and they have very different music styles. We've seen a lot of praise music. We've seen tambourines that are just set on the seat so people can play them, things like that. So sometimes there's a prohibition in these other churches on a style of music, like rock music or anything that has a downbeat, because it's not their traditional style. The truth is that we have no idea what kind of music or what kind of beat David danced to when he danced before the Ark of God. But we do
know. It had to be one he could dance to.
It had to be one. I give it a 2 for danceability.
And I doubt it was a 3-4 waltz.
Well, what we do know is that David said to praise God with timbrel, that's a tambourine, and dance. And that in Ezra 3:10, it talks about using trumpets and cymbals to praise God. I seriously doubt that that sounded like anything they composed in the 1800s. Mm-hmm. Such an approach of sticking with tradition removes any chance of experimentation that's necessary to bring in fresh new music. It's doubtful that their corporate officers and employees are really even capable of finding modern congregational music that works. Many times the ability to investigate and select new music resides in a few of the local church people who are actually skilled musicians.
Yeah.
The best way for a corporate church to bring in new music is to let the people who are, you know, skilled musicians experiment with it. We have to be open to trying new styles and new artists, and of course there are going to be stumbles along the way.
Yeah.
Some of the songs won't work, but if fear of failure is what guides us, then we're all doomed. Uh-huh. We must be willing to fail. It's only through risk that we can succeed.
Okay.
Yeah, I guess let me add, and I'll talk about this later when I talk about the Philippines, that they had a lot of young people involved in the music there. And I think they were really enthusiastic about the songs. And I heard songs I had never heard a song before. Songs that were new to me that were beautiful. They were really well done. Mm-hmm. And they put the music out for people to sing along with. It was just great. And I guess the thing about music, and like you made very good points, is that music is expression. So for me, I want to, and worship is expression, right? We want to worship God. We want to express things to God.
Right.
So sometimes for me, I can't express who I am by something somebody wrote in the 1800s because I don't connect with that.
Right.
But some of this younger music or upbeat music, a young person can express themselves to God the way they will actually feel. And that's very important to young people to be able to express themselves.
And we know they're going to get exposed to the older stuff, and some of them might connect with some of that. I wanted
Absolutely.
To read a couple of the comments.
Okay, go ahead.
All right, Super Jim says the Toronto church calls out a lot of hallelujahs, and we have been in Toronto, and we know they're very praiseful
and
open.
Yeah, if you want an example of a church that can praise the Lord,
Toronto. We've been
church.
To Toronto.
They,
love it up there.
They are. Yeah. So that is in contrast with much
right.
of the.
So a comment from Beth and Ed, and I'm not sure who gets credit for this, Beth or Ed, said I played Big Daddy Weave's Lion and Lamb in Sabbath School last week. All right. So don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. A mix of new and traditional music is good, I think. And I think that's true. We were talking beforehand how our praise band group just actually plays some of the traditional hymns with drums and guitars and mm-hmm. keyboards and, you know, a cowbell or mm-hmm. two, that type of thing. So
love the cowbell.
Jeff says we're supposed to praise God with psalms and spiritual songs. He says, I would not call modern Christian music or the so-called praise music in this category. Like any music, listen to and read the words.
Okay.
But, you know, traditional hymns can say things about God being a Trinity or going to heaven or, you know, praising about the cross and stuff like that. So the words could be wrong there, too. So that's a good point. Listen
to and what do we do with those hymns? We change the words to match
a little bit
to adjust to the match our beliefs. Okay. And with modern songs, I think we can adjust them.
All right, let me say something about this. Remember one song we used to sing all the time in the old church? It was Blessed and Happy in the Man. It is the Man.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a line in the song that goes, he shall be a tree that grows planted by the riverside. Technically, that's not correct. Because in ancient Israel, these were canals that they had built. Mm-hmm. And there's a big difference between a natural river and a man-made canal. And if you look at the original psalm that was written and go into the translation of those words, it was not a riverside, it was the side of a canal. So even that one song that was so sacred to us years ago was kind of technically incorrect.
Yeah.
So we have to be careful when we talk about this kind of stuff. All right, let's move on to the next one. Okay, we got to get into the next point here. Before we do it, I want to read something by Michael McCarty. Michael McCarty writes, he says, the more unified the church becomes, the more young people will stay.
I agree. Yeah.
I mean, this may be the most profound statement of the evening.
Right.
He says, many young people in the church are torn apart by splits and have friends in other COGs. They have a hard time seeing these friends because of the splits. We are doing a good job of developing unity among the church as we should. And then he talks about divisive doctrines.
Now, a word on unity, though. We are united by the love of Christ, by the Holy Spirit that's through us. We don't have to be exactly alike. And I think that's part of the problem.
Right.
United doesn't mean identical. And it doesn't have to mean identical. So we don't want to go back to that. Everyone has to be exactly the same.
And we don't have to be in the same, organization.
No.
There has to be a unity, like what we're doing in the feast.
You're still
in the other feast. There's a unity of spirit.
Right. Y'all are stealing my thunder now. You know.
Oh, no, sorry.
All right. Let's talk about factions, okay?
It's kind of a segue.
Okay.
The American founding fathers were smart enough to see what would happen to the United States if factionalism prevailed. In fact, the founding fathers were actually prophetic in their warnings, in that their warnings were on the spot. Look at where we are now. This country is factionalized and polarized to the point where the federal legislature and the executive branch can't even work together to solve problems. Problems that they both acknowledge need to be worked on. They simply can't do it. And the sad part of this whole concept of factionalism is that we're seeing out there is that the churches of God were ahead of their time on this practice of factionalism. This is so sad. There has been factionalism in the churches of God since at least 1970s, at least. And so many of you out there have lived through the factionalism through those decades since the 1970s. Today, there are too many churches of God that are looking out for what's best for their faction versus what's best for the overall body of Christ.
So that's tactical.
Exactly. It's a tactical instead of strategic thinking. Mm-hmm. How many times have I heard the following, and I just read this from, who's this, from Michael. How many times have I heard the following? Young people, whether they're new or whether they're raised in the church, they say, I don't understand why we have this factionalism in the church. Mm-hmm. They hear us preach that there is only one body of Christ. Don't we
one
preach
Lord,
that?
One faith, one God.
There's only one body of Christ.
Baptism.
But then they see that there's an actual practice of there being many, many 501c3 church corporations, most of which will not have anything to do with each other. Mm-hmm. Now, no one on this program, let's add this, no one here at Bob's is suggesting we have a great big corporate kumbaya reunification of all the churches of God. It's not going to happen.
No, never.
And it shouldn't happen.
Yeah.
We are separated by organizational structures, and that's not necessarily bad. What's bad is when these corporations, these 501c3s that call themselves the Church of God, when they refuse to work together for the common good. And worse, and it even gets worse, some churches of God don't even acknowledge that other groups are indeed their brothers and sisters in the body of Christ. They say, oh, that group over there, they're not even converted. Or they say, oh, that group, they may be converted, but they're only the Laodicean church. Now, I know of one minister. He's an independent in the Church of God movement. And he likes to play these cutesy-poo little games when it comes to his refusal to cooperate with other Church of God organizations. He says things like this. He says, while I'm for one-on-one cooperation with CGS, the Church of God people, I am not for corporate cooperation with other Church of God groups. This is crazy.
So I will come to your house for a barbecue. I'll come to your house for a barbecue, but I'm not coming to your church.
I heard this guy say this from the pulpit, I don't know how many times.
It makes no sense.
He also says this. He says, I refuse to have anything to do with other ministers in these churches that I've had run-ins with over the years, but I'll be with them in the kingdom of God. Really?
Does he really
believe that
we can't
God,
judge that, but
does he really believe that God is not going to hold it against them that he refused to cooperate with and work with other ministers in this age? Does he really believe that God is going to say, well, of course, you're obstinate in your refusal to work with your brothers in Christ before the return of Jesus, and that was okay? I don't think it works that way. If you are hearing this message, you have a responsibility to tell the leadership of your church that if they want your continued support, your leadership must show love for their brothers and sisters in the other churches of God. No excuses, no back talk. You just do it. In the Church of God, many brethren still haven't figured out the following principle. These leaders who are acting bad can only act bad if you let them.
If you let them.
If their donation base dries up, they have nothing. They can only do the things that they do because you support them with your tithes and offerings. If all the brethren would require Christian behavior out of the leadership in the churches of God, I think there's a really good chance that these guys would do a better job of showing love and being cooperative with other ministries.
But they actually tell the other people, don't associate with us.
They tell them. They tell their people.
And they have families that they tell, don't associate with your family members.
Don't talk to your family because they're in another Church of God group. You're in our Church of God group. You don't even talk to your own family.
And of course young people don't like that.
No. Young people, no.
Because they see how stupid it is.
In the Church of God, we have gotten used to other ministries slapping our hands away. We reach out the right hand of fellowship and we get slapped away. Mm-hmm.
So we reach out the left hand.
Yeah, well, we're kind of like Larry on the Three Stooges. There's a story, I don't know if this is true or not, but people say that the left side of Larry's face had a permanent callus from Mo always slapping there. I don't know if that's true or not, but that's a story that goes around on the Three Stooges websites that I frequent. We have calluses on our hands from constantly reaching out to others. Usually we fail, but sometimes we succeed. The brethren in CGI are enthusiastically behind the efforts of the CGI ministry and their efforts to work with others. And we praise God for these efforts.
Yes.
Sometimes we succeed. Let me give you a little sneak preview. All right. Now, can y'all keep a secret out there?
I can, Jeff. Okay. Can you keep a secret?
I'm talking about the folks out there.
Oh.
Yeah, all everybody out there, all okay. 100 or 200.
Okay.
Yeah,
keep a secret. Just that's just between us now, okay? Right, just a secret. At this time, you know we're going to have a joint feast site with Christian Educational Ministries and CGI at the Land Between the Lakes in Kentucky.
But that's not the secret.
That's not the secret. That's already out. And we're also having a joint women's conference with Christian Educational Ministries.
We are.
Okay, but guess what?
What?
Now, I got an email last week from a pastor of another church group.
A big church group.
Big church. Now, don't give too many hints now.
Okay, all right. Jeff. All right, or it could be a small church.
Or maybe somewhere in between.
It's a church and it's a group.
This minister, he said that he and his congregation have been given the blessing of their corporate offices to go in with us at the Land Between the Lakes Feast site. Another Church of God group wants to come in with us on this. And I'm sorry I can't tell you their name, but it's happening. And if anybody denies it, I've got it in writing.
Right.
Seriously, this is great. Praise God. And I'm going to estimate that for every, I don't know what it is, 10 times, 25, 50 times, every 50 times we get our hands slapped away when we reach out to others and we get one response. Mm-hmm. I'll take, like Larry on the Three Stooges, I'll take those 50 slaps anytime if it means getting that one acceptance.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Those 50 slaps are worth it in order to get the one reconciliation.
A lot of hoorays and yays on the group.
Good.
And right. I don't think it's for slapping you.
Oh, I thought it was
for... No, it's for the group.
Young people are tired of church wars.
They are.
Absolutely.
They're tired
of it. I'm tired too, and I'm not all that young.
They're tired of
attending. Old people are tired of church.
Old people
are
all tired. Jeff. Jeff's calling me old. Did you hear him call me old?
No. I'm saying, and young people like Nancy
Young people like Nancy. Young people are tired of attending a church and not seeing their friends there, like we just read from Michael, because their leadership got into some squabble and quit and split the church. And now their friends are at another church. It could be two blocks down the road.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And they're fellowshipping separately. Mm-hmm. Factionalism has got to be destroyed in the church of God. Mm-hmm. Again, we're not advocating a big corporate merger of the groups. No. We don't need that. What we need is to start really showing love and working together with those who we've separated
from. Or the sermon from a couple weeks ago, you know, we say we can love each other, but do we like them?
Like,
who gave that sermon?
I can't think of his name off the top of my
head.
He's
a visitor from Kansas.
We'll look it up in the break.
It's a great sermon.
Yeah, we'll look it up.
We recommend it.
Yeah, absolutely recommend it on our website.
We'll look it up during the break.
Yes.
We've got to answer the question, do we really want to do things to get and keep people? Do we really want to do that?
Yeah.
Because if the answer is yes, we've got to make changes. Mm-hmm. And now we're getting into some really uncomfortable discussions, and people are saying, well, I don't know if I can do that. All right, one more thing.
It was Raymond Coleman.
Raymond Coleman. Yeah. Raymond Coleman,
thank you, Wesley. Thank you, Wesley. He's not just a pretty
that
face.
That was two weeks ago, Raymond Coleman sermon, and we recommend it. It's online right now. Have you got it online?
It may not be because I've been gone to the Philippines,
okay,
but it will be online very soon.
Very soon. All right, everybody make note of that. One more thing. I got some more unpleasant news, because that's what we've got for you tonight. Attracting young people means we've got to change. And we're not done with our list, okay? Are you willing to change? We don't want you to change your doctrines. Mm-hmm. We're asking you to change the way you deal with others. Mm-hmm. Are you willing to make those changes? We're going to take a short break. When we come back, we're going to go through some more areas that need to be discussed. And I want to let you know now, we're going to put this presentation tonight on a YouTube video.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we hope that you will look at that YouTube video and share it with others.
Share it with those other churches of God that need to hear this.
Yeah. Right.
We want to hear from you in our chat room and our email. Email wdwhite@yahoo.com. Stay with us, please.
wdwhite49.
I'm sorry, wdwhite49@yahoo.com. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
When we think about the Bible, we hardly ever think about sports. Sure, the Apostle Paul uses the metaphor of running a race, but there's just not a lot of stuff about athletic events in the Bible. But sports did have a profound impact on Christianity. Welcome to Connecting History and the Bible. I'm Wes White of CGI.org. Now, let's go to Indianapolis, Indiana. I'm standing in front of the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, home of the Indianapolis 500 and the Brickyards 400. Now, many people think that NFL football is the most popular sport in the United States, but NASCAR beats the pants off the NFL when it comes to attendance and dollars spent. It was the same in ancient Rome during the time of the apostles. When we look back in history, we usually think that gladiator competition in the Colosseum was the most popular sport during the time of Christ, but a much more popular sport was chariot racing. And the granddaddy of all chariot racing stadiums was the humongous Circus Maximus. The Circus Maximus held crowds of somewhere between 50,000 and 87,000 people. The historians can't agree on the exact number. The Romans had their hearts broken when the Circus Maximus burned down. It started with a small fire in the bleacher section that it spread and destroyed the whole stadium. Then it spread to the surrounding houses and burned down a large part of the city of Rome, making thousands of people homeless. Who or what started this fire? It was probably the Roman Emperor Nero who had it burned down so that he could build a new palace. You see, the Circus Maximus was located on prime real estate, a perfect place for his new royal home. Needless to say, the Romans were angry, not just at the loss of their beloved sports stadium, but also at the loss of their homes. If they ever found out that Nero had caused this fire, there would have been a revolution. So Nero cleverly blamed the fire on a small group of fanatics called Christians, and this took the blame off of himself. And to show what a good emperor he was, he started killing Christians as punishment for their alleged arson. And at first, the Romans were overjoyed to watch the persecution of these people that had caused their losses. But then things started to change. The Romans began seeing the Christians for what they really were, a kind and gentle people who followed the teachings that were taught in a thing called the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. The Romans could see that these Christians were dying for what they believed. This affected the Romans. And the next step was for the Romans to actually start sympathizing with the Christians. The final step was for the Romans to become so impressed with the Christians that they began converting to this strange religion. Within a few years, there were thousands of new Christian converts in the city of Rome. So here we see how God used a sport that was not too different than car racing to spread his church. Next time you see the NFL or NASCAR, think about the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. For more information, please contact us at CGI.org, and we'll see you next time on Connecting History and the Bible.
In the early days of the church, there was a great controversy between Jewish Christians and Gentile Christians. A dividing line seemed to have been drawn between converts of Jerusalem apostles and congregations led by Paul. We know that there was a time when Paul was upset with Peter over issues dealing with the treatment of Gentiles. Was it a situation where Paul taught that the law was done away with? Or was it a situation where Paul taught against a perverse and apostate religion that claimed to represent the teachings of the Old Testament? We would like to offer you a free booklet entitled The Book of Galatians, a Commentary. It's free. You can get it here at cgi.org. Again, the title is The Book of Galatians, a Commentary at cgi.org.
Before we continue our list of areas where we need to do better when it comes to attracting and keeping young people, let's hear about Jeff's trip to the Philippines.
Oh, yes, a wonderful trip to the Philippines. I guess last week, some of y'all were actually had tuned in.
Yep.
And we had the webcast at 8 o'clock, and you could actually see services from Manila.
It was great.
And I've never had the experience like I had in Manila.
Oh, yeah.
When Bill and I both arrived, we got there about an hour, almost an hour and a half early because I had to set up for the webcast.
Mm-hmm.
And when I walked in, everybody was already there.
Oh, wow.
And they were waiting on us.
They were excited.
And we walked in, they were clapping happy to have us. So I was feeling kind of sick from the day before. I actually had no sleep before, and it was running a fever when I walked into the building. I was hoping somebody would give me some ibuprofen.
Uh-huh.
But when I walked in and everybody's clapping and the excitement and all the love that was there, I completely
felt
better.
So you were like buoyed by the Holy Spirit.
I felt 100% change in how I felt.
Nice.
And then everybody wanted to take a picture. Everybody will take a picture.
Feel like a superstar.
Pose for a picture with this group and pose for a picture with this group. I mean, I was posing more pictures than Mickey Mouse at Disneyland that day. It was quite a lot of photo ops. So we had the webcast and we had a great service. Really great music. We were talking about music a little bit earlier. Wonderful performances from two different choirs that were there.
Wow.
And we'll have the replay is still up. It's under our webcast replays right here if you wanted to see some of that.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of those people who were watching along, I saw their comments, and they could see it was talent and very, everybody was really reverent of the Sabbath. Just a wonderful, wonderful group to meet with. And they gave me a gift.
All right.
From Manila, and if I can show this, will this show up? Can you see this?
Look at that. I love that caricature.
All right, so this is my caricature.
All right.
And if you look, I'll put up there, you can kind of see all these signatures wishes for the Philippines. And they did want a bill also that's caricature. I don't have it because he took his. But.
Can I see that?
Let me pass
so,
it over here.
So John Black says that the people from the Philippines said the last time someone came to see them from headquarters was Garner Ted Armstrong.
It was Garner Ted Armstrong. So we have been a little delayed.
Remiss in
visiting out there. But we're going to send more people more often. I'm pretty sure of it.
That's wonderful.
I'm going to tell you my story. So I went to there, and then the next day went to a place called Naga City, which is a 1 hour flight from Manila.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a smaller group because it's more country. Mm-hmm. Than Manila City. I mean, I've never been to a city with a traffic like Manila and people on motors and traffic and honk, 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 honk. I guess it's like New York. I mean, I've never been in a city that big. It was just people everywhere. And when they had like during rush hour traffic, people, vendors would come out on the road and sell people stuff.
Taking advantage of you.
So very industrious folks out there. People know how to earn a living. But went to Naga City the next day, and it was the country, so a completely different atmosphere from Manila.
Mm-hmm.
And a beautiful country, a lot of rice farms that were out there. And we were able to get there just in time for Bill to do a public Bible study. With this gigantic poster behind of himself, which was kind of a little embarrassing to him, but they love to put that kind of stuff together, these big giant posters.
Really, like the emperor of North Korea.
Really nice poster. But it looked really nice, and just, you know, not something we're used to, because we don't usually make gigantic posters of our speakers, but it was, but the people there were really attentive. They listened to the Bible study, really good Bible study, and they had a good time. And afterwards, we were invited to go eat. They gave us some gifts also. They gave us some t-shirts, which I don't have a t-shirt. And also I got this gift right here.
Oh yeah.
Which is from the children in Naga City. And they have little personal notes they wrote.
Very nice.
Picture of them. I was like, what? So I got something there I can put on the wall as well. Very nice gift. Also, you know what? And then I'm kind of jumping ahead of myself. I want to go back and I want to show you let's go ahead and show this picture. We have, this is Manila. So I want to give you an idea of Manila before we go to back to Naga City. This is over 200 people were there. This is a filled up auditorium full of people, as you can see in this picture right here. And also another guy who's a friend of Wes's on Facebook, John Israel.
Oh yeah.
Okay, so here's a picture of him. He mentioned, said, would you mention me on Bring on the Sabbath? I said, we'll do better than that. We got a picture of you. John. Oh, good, John. So if you're watching or watch the replay, John, great guy. It was great to meet you and to meet so many other people that I have not met. So Naga City, We had a meal afterwards, got to eat a lot of local cuisines. Mm-hmm. And then the next day, they were keeping us moving. The next day we went to Tegate, and I probably, my pronunciations are not great, but Tegate. And this is a wonderful place to keep the Feast of Tabernacles. It's overlooking a Taal volcano, which is a crater. And the hotel, top-notch, five-star hotel that they meet in, wonderful facility, everything you would imagine, and better. Prices are, compared to here, great prices, great food there. Mm-hmm. If you're looking for a destination, resort type of area for your Feast of Tabernacles, and you've already been to Europe, you've been down to South America, go to the Philippines, because you could, your money will go by. Things are cheaper there. The accommodations are great, and the people are wonderful, and they would love to have a lot more visitors come there from you know, and again, since we're open, from any Church of God.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
Any Church of God is welcome to attend our Feast of Tabernacles, and we'll mm-hmm. welcome you. Welcome you with open
and
arms.
We won't even check to make sure that you are giving your offering to CGI.
We don't even check.
Have to give it to your home church. That's perfect.
Give it to your home church and come to CGI.
Okay, cool.
I have another picture here, but I'll get to that picture in a second. So we went to Naga City, went to Tegate with the Feast of Tabernacles. And the last one, and here's the picture, bring up the picture. We also went to they have a really pretty good headquarters there at the IBM building in Manila. We have the Church of God International headquarters. And we're going to do a documentary. And you can see, here's an interview. Bill is interviewing Renee, who is the office manager and minister in the Church of God International there. And we're doing an interview about what they've been doing. They have they distribute 20,000 copies of the Armor of God magazine, which they edit and publish there. And they have 10,000 they mail out, and another 10,000 they go hand out on the street. Put a new,
is it an entirely Philippines crafted version?
Yes,
is it the American version translated?
Yeah, we don't have a magazine. Uh-huh. So they have the Armor Guide magazine, and we thought, well, if we ever did do a magazine, we could always just take that and distribute that. But they do a really good magazine.
Wonderful.
And they distribute a lot of copies, and they get a lot of response from that. So they're doing so many things, and so within probably, I'm not going to give any time period because we have a lot of work to do. I have hours and hours and hours of footage. I have footage on my phone. Of all kinds of different places, cool. and Bill has a lot of footage on his phone. We're going to put together a documentary showing about the folks in the Philippines and what they're doing, and try to bring some highlight to a part of the Church of God International that many of y'all may not know too much about.
Cool.
And so we wanted to really let you know that it's exciting. I'm energized and I'm pumped up after visiting because they're full of the Spirit out there, doing the work of God.
Great.
Excellent.
Great.
Nancy, why don't you do a quick plug of the Women's Conference?
All right. Well, the Women's Conference is coming up in less than a month.
Whoa.
Yep. It's in April, April 9th and 10th. It's a Saturday and a
less
Sunday.
Less than a month. Feel like it's been forever now.
we have
finally
planned.
Made it.
It takes
finally
a lot of planning we have. Yep. We're almost there. You can get all the details you need at the website, newchurchlady.org. And I want to remind everyone that there is a blog there. Written and usually published once a week, and even if you can't make the conference, you can get an idea of what our heart is with this conference by reading the blog.
Yeah, I think a lot of ladies, if they knew that your blog was out there week after week, they'd want to be on this website. So why don't y'all
there we go.
Get on Nancy's blog and on that website and check this stuff out. New Church Lady. Okay, Jeff, give us a plug for all the feast sites that we're doing this year.
All right, so now I added a plug for the Philippines feast site. Yeah. So it's a wonderful international feast site you can be a part of. And again, we have the feast site that you mentioned in Land Between the Lakes. We have Myrtle Beach, mm-hmm. Oklahoma.
Wagner,
Oklahoma. We have in Florida, down in two
Saint
places.
Pete.
In St. Pete, mm-hmm. and in Destin.
Fort Walton.
Mm-hmm. Destin area
mm-hmm. there. That group feast site, yeah.
And I don't know if I missed anybody, but that kind of, and we also have in Canada, feast site there in Canada, which is all
Ontario, isn't it?
Ontario.
Don't you have a couple in Canada? Just one.
We have one in Canada so far.
Okay. Okay.
And that's on our website, and as the information becomes available, will be on the website, and we're hoping we'll put together a really nice part of the website for the one in the Philippines, so you can get an idea that it's great for those who like to travel.
Right. Okay.
I want to put in a real quick a plug here. Just take a second. I got an email from Alan Ruth regarding his website. It's called BibleStudy.org. Mm-hmm. And feel free to check this out. Not now, because we're in the middle of a show, but BibleStudy.org.
I've been there on the website.
Yeah. It's a really good website. Yeah. They've been around for like 20 years. This is their 20th year anniversary. In the year 2015, they had a total of over 9 million hits. Mm-hmm. And this year, in 2016, they made their 1 millionth hit already in February. They made their second millionth hit by March 8th. So I encourage everybody to check out the BibleStudy.org website. This was put together 20 years ago before people recognized the value of social media, and Alan Ruth has done a terrific job.
And he got a great name for the website, BibleStudy.org.
He got in on the ground floor, and there have been people who have been wanting that website address from him, and he won't give it up. I think he's been offered a whole bunch of money, and Alan, correct me if I'm wrong.
It's worth a lot of money.
It's worth a lot of money, but he was smart. He got it early, and it's a great website, so check it out. All right, Nancy, let's get back to our discussion about young people. What's our next point?
Well, didn't you want to to answer this question? And someone requested that we clarify what a 501c3 is.
Oh, before we do that, you have to clarify something about the Land Between the Lakes fee site.
I have a comment that
came
in
from
Priscilla on Facebook. And she says, we've always had a bit of a mixed bag as far as representation of different churches of God to attend the Kentucky Dam Village. I remember we had different churches of God already visiting.
Right.
And she says, but it's good to know that it will be done more openly and publicly on a more corporate scale this year.
Yeah.
So we're really pushing it.
So previously you had to say,
before we said, well, we're open Fleeside, but it's the Church of God International Fleeside.
When we got back from Land Between the Lakes, I said, we are going to publicize this to death. And we have really pushed Land Between the Lakes. It's going to be a great feast. Okay, you've got a question.
Yes. Would you want to clarify what is a 501c3? We talk about that a lot, so other people might not know what that means.
501c3 is a nonprofit organization that's usually church. Mm-hmm. They set themselves up so that members can easily get tax deductions on their donations. That's why we set up 501c3s. Most of the churches of God that you see out there have a 501c3 set up. And I don't know what they call them in Canada, but that's what we call them in the United States.
BibleStudy.org, that website is probably a 501c3.
I don't know.
Maybe a nonprofit, but not a 501c3?
Know. It might just be Alan doing it by himself.
A lot of times when they do org,
All right, Nancy, let's go to our next one. Let's get this thing going.
Evangelism. All right. Yeah. Every year, our churches spend thousands of dollars on programs that worked well in the 60s and 70s. These programs that were the mainstay of churches in my parents' day are pretty ineffective today, at least for young people, if you're trying to track them. These, you know, kind of talking head behind the desk programs they're sacred cows to some church leaders who are afraid to replace them with modern tools such as Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Periscope. But here at CGI, we're not afraid, right?
We're doing this, aren't we?
Oh, yeah, that's right. We're on the web. But when leadership finally learns how these social media tools work, you know, they get flustered because they're old and they realize they don't have the skills to effectively use them. So instead of stepping out of the way and letting younger people use these tools to effectively evangelize for the church, they recoil because everyone knows, and I'm just like air quoting here, everyone knows that evangelism should be done by, at best, evangelists, or at worst, by seasoned ministers. And we can't allow unordained people like women or young people to become new faces representing, you know, this church of God. So young people want to help in this way. And they've been using these tools since they were toddlers with their little pudgy fingers using some kind of iPad that their parents gave them. Many of them know more about what works and doesn't work on social media than I could learn in a full semester of training at college. Plus, they probably have hundreds of thousands of connections on social media already of people who are following them.
Yes.
That means ready-made connections for them to push out a gospel message.
Say that last sentence again. That's a very important sentence.
That means ready-made connections for the gospel message.
Ready-made connections for the gospel. They're out there.
Yeah.
Our kids have them, and we're not using them.
That's right.
Okay.
Now, young people may need guidance on subject matter and doctrine, maybe. But they certainly are ready, willing, and able to help preach the gospel in this way. The thing is that technology is growing at an exponential rate. By the time even I learned how to use Facebook, my kids were already ready to move on to something else. Facebook is now territory for middle-aged folks. I confess that I've never used Vine or Periscope, and I barely use Instagram. We need to put these tools in the hands of the people who have the skill. And if it's a woman or a millennial, then that just gives us old folks some time for doing other things, like bringing food to potluck.
That's right. We said this evening, this is a dialogue. We want your input. And I want to share some of the comments that you've sent us. Right. Ron Kuykendall writes, he says, probably there's a combination of issues that contribute to this problem. He said, here's a few ideas that I have. He says, number one, young people are drawn into what's going on in the entertainment industry and among their friends. Number two, young people want to be free to do whatever they feel like doing, and they see church as an impediment to doing that. Number three, when they are in their teens, they start seeing hypocrisy in the church. We've already discussed that. Mm-hmm. Number four, they also, now this is a good point. I'm glad he sent this. They also start seeing Bible stories from a human reasoning standpoint. They see the incredible stories of the Bible like a serpent speaking. And they say, wait a minute, a serpent is speaking? You got to be kidding me. And they sadly lose faith in the Bible and turn loose the faith in the church and just want to go their own way. And that's why these miraculous things that are in the Bible, we need to talk about them from an intelligent point of view, which we don't do enough. And that's why I'm looking forward to going through this Genesis series that we're going to start in May. Mm-hmm. And we're going to talk about a serpent speaking and what's that all about. Mm-hmm. And Moses going through the Red Sea and all these kind of things. Young people can have problems with accepting these things that we accept, and we've got to deal with them. All right, these are good points, Ron. And if anybody out there has more comments, let us know. We have the following from Bob Phelps, who says, and I'm only going to pick out one important part of Bob's message. He says, one point is, he said, the mindset of the church as a whole would have to move a bit to the left. That's a very interesting perspective. And I believe that when Bob says he feels the mindset of the church needs to move left, I don't think he's necessarily saying that the church needs to become liberal or leftist.
Right.
I don't think he's saying that. I think what he's suggesting is that the church, for the most part, is at this time to the right and needs to come to the center if we're going to be able to attract and keep young people. I think, and please let me know if I've got this wrong, Bob, I think that Bob is suggesting that we need to be centrist or perhaps even apolitical in the church because politics in the church turns off young people. And let's talk about that.
Well,
hot button issue. Okay.
I got a comment that came in while you were talking.
Okay.
Another one on the Facebook Messenger. So, yeah, if you want to send messages, send me on Facebook and I'll get them. We were talking about young people using things that they know well.
Mm-hmm.
And this is from Beth, who wanted me to mention lampstand greetings. That is a reference that's on there. You may have seen this. It's in our Facebook group.
Mm-hmm.
And she makes like e-cards and holy day cards and resources that people can share with each other.
These type of
things. And then, you know, young person using their gifts to do that. And there'll be some cards soon for Happy Passover and the Days of Unleavened Bread cards.
Those are hard. You can sometimes find Passover cards in bigger cities.
Look for lampstand greetings on Facebook.
Okay.
And again, that's definitely...
All right.
I have a comment in chat.
All right.
So, Carl says that BibleStudy.org is not a 501c3, so thanks for doing the research.
Thank you. I didn't think it was.
Yeah. And he also mentions that to target younger people in the videos, you need to be under 5 minutes and aren't connecting history in the Bible and Bible Q&A generally.
Yeah, I think sometimes people think that young people have a short attention span, and so they should be short. But I found, and this is my research, that young people will watch things that go 30 minutes to an hour, but it has to be interesting to them.
Has to be interesting to the point, not just droning on because you've got 30 minutes to talk.
Yeah, there's some people, I won't make any names, that are Church of God leaders that I can't sit through for 5 minutes.
Right.
Not CGI, I'm talking about others. Yeah.
Okay.
And you can understand how that goes.
Okay.
All right, let's go back to Bob Phelps' comment because we got to talk about politics. We're really getting into a sensitive area here.
Yeah.
Today, many branches of the Church of God have become so establishment, some more than others, that they are openly right-wing Republican in their sermons. And I would talk about, right now, the Churches of God that have leftist leanings, but I haven't run across any yet. And if you know of one, let me know, because I want to hear about this. I want to know about it. I want to be educated. And we're talking about some groups. Other groups are more subtle in their efforts to promote Republicanism. And while this less blatant approach keeps politics out of the pulpit, the members receive their church leaders' promotions of biased news via emails, tweets, and Facebook posts. It's a problem for young people when our members equate right-wing politics or left-wing politics with Christianity. Young people see this and they know better than to equate those things. Now, there are some areas of overlap between Christianity and conservatism, like our teaching against abortion. That's an area of overlap. The liberals also have some overlap with Christianity when it comes to things like helping the poor and forgiving sinners. No political party can be labeled as the party that represents the beliefs of the Church of God. And let's be frank here. I'm going to be really frank. When many of us left the old organization, we moved away from things like top-down church government, one true church, church eras, and end-time apostles. And it was good that we rejected these teachings. But the rejection of other teachings has not always had a good effect on the body of Christ. And some of you have probably got a million examples, but I'm just going to give you one. Even though the old organization was conservative in many ways, our leaders back then discouraged us from getting involved in politics because they knew it could develop into a time waster, keeping us from praying and studying our Bibles. And now that we're free to embrace worldly politics to our heart's content, many of our people have done so to such a degree that it indeed has become a detriment to their prayer, to their Bible study, and their service to the church. And when a local church starts aligning itself with the Republican Party, it immediately alienates many minorities and young people. And let's state the converse. If a local church were to start aligning itself with the Democratic Party, it too would immediately alienate a lot of people. The point is that no church should ally itself with any political party. The local church needs to be an oasis of Bible learning where the brethren are spiritually nourished and loved in a politically neutral environment. Now, let's look at some numbers here. Once we turn off prospective members who are left of center by promoting the Republican brand in church, we have automatically lost 50% of the potential new brethren. On the other side, once we turn off prospective members who are right of center by promoting the Democratic brand, we have automatically lost 50% of our potential new brethren. We can't afford to lose 50% of our potential new brethren on either side of the political spectrum. The way we're doing it now, here's the danger, and I'm being very frank. I'm not deliberately trying to be offensive, but someone's got to say this because no one's saying it. If our current demographic trends continue, we will continue on our path of being a collection of angry old people with no hope of bringing in young people and people of color. And to that, some of our members just might say amen because they prefer to have Sabbath fellowship only with people of their political persuasion.
Or age group.
Yeah.
They're not interested.
They're
not interested in reaching out to others who are different when it comes to how they vote or how they look or what age they are. And indeed, if this continued behavior in the churches of God will keep them comfortable for another 10 or 20 years as they worship with others who look like them, think like them, believe like them. If they do this, this is a great tactical strategy. You got that word? You still got those two words?
Yep.
Tactical versus strategic. But what happens after these folks start dying off? Another church closes its doors because their formula for fellowship is a toxic elixir guaranteed to destroy any chance of bringing in new converts. This is strategic suicide for the church. Nancy.
I think we're going to have to wrap it up, babe.
Why, we're out of time?
It's already 9 o'clock.
9 o'clock.
We told them we'd finish this tonight. Are we going to have to finish this next week? Are we losing people? People jumping out of the room?
All right, let's go.
Well, I don't know. Maybe we shouldn't.
We should wrap it up. I think, I mean, yeah, we've got two more good points, but I think if we don't make them, we'll be all right.
Let's wrap it up. Let's take a break. We'll be right back.
We were ready for a break.
Okay, we're recording.
Sorry, just a tip.
Yeah, no problem.
Okay. Is that good?
Mm-hmm. Ready? Quiet in the set.
I love the Lord because He heard my voice, my supplication.
The Christian church was born on the day of Pentecost. This was approximately 7 weeks after Jesus was crucified and resurrected. And on that birthday of the church, Peter preached the church's first sermon, where he said to repent. Repentance was the first command given to the body of Christ. And if those folks back then had not repented, they couldn't have become part of the church. That's right, because repentance is at the heart of the kingdom of God's message. Also, repentance is actually a gift. You may find these things hard to believe. If so, you need to ask for our free booklet entitled 10 Facts You Should Know About Repentance. It's free. You can get it at our website at cgi.org. Again, that's 10 Facts You Should Know About Repentance at cgi.org.
We're back. We got a thing from Jeremy Brown in Montgomery, Alabama. He's a young person. We're always glad to get stuff from young people. You're going to post this on the CGI website. What's the title of it?
He just sent an article that's called What Today's Leaders Lack.
What Today's Leaders Lack. So watch for that on the CGI website. We're so sorry we ran out of time. Next week, you come back here at 7:30. We are going to finish this thing. If it kills us, if we have to shoot Buckaroo and not let him do the puppet show, we're going to finish this next week.
Man. So, we'll shoot the Buckaroo.
Okay, then we'll shoot Yankee Dan. But anyway, thank you so much for being with us. See you next week, 7:30 Central Time, here on CGI.org. In the meantime,
have a good Sabbath.
Wow.
Nothing is surer than death and taxes. Millions of people pay taxes every day, and millions of people die every day. We have all lost loved ones through death. Death is a dreaded enemy. Death is not a friend. Many people have great fear when they think about their own deaths and deaths of others who are close to them. What happens when you die? Do you have an immortal soul that either goes up to heaven or down to an ever-burning hell after you die? It's time you learn the answers to these questions. We can help you. We have a booklet called Afraid to Die. You can get it on our website at cgi.org. It's free. Again, that's Afraid to Die at cgi.org.